Value.
Same price as the seats at the back. I would appreciate if you can come in front. It will help us.
This will.
So we have a small.
Okay.
But sheet with us.
And this come. Okay.
We have a small sheet with us.
If the stock market just goes blank, if it goes. Okay.
And if it'll keep on.
Meanwhile, this is Chandrasekhar.
I'll take.
Chandrasekhar Raman, an active Sanskrit Bharati volunteer at Ramu Jaya. He teaches Sanskrit at Raman Tree and many other specific texts and other. So anybody wants to learn Sanskrit, can contact him.
Yet anantaram dadmaha. Anantaram eva dadmaha.
Anantaram.
Anantaram. Yada karyam praramam bhavati tada dadmaha.
Tada eva dadmaha.
Purva pitikam samapayato. Anantaram dadmaha. Tat karyam karoti.
So many of us would be understanding, would be thinking how to study this Sanskrit language. Is it very difficult? Sanskrit Bharati has a song, it says, Naiva Klishta Na Chakatim. So it is not difficult, it's very easy. Provided we have the right guru and the right steps we take. Every Vidya is like that. Now with Sanskritam, there are one anecdote which I want to tell. So one day, as I told you, we go in Chaturmasyam to meet our Jagadguru of Sringeri. So one of many people asked the Jagadguru that what is the level at which I have to study Sanskritam? How much Sanskritam should I study? Because it is never ending. Yesterday one of the student here, one of the participant here, he said, I've been studying Sanskritam for almost 18 years and still it is not over. So I'm glad he said that. Even we have been studying Sanskritam for 25 years, 30 years, it's not yet over, and we are never able to see where we are never able to see the end of it. So if that is the case, the question to the Jagadguru was, how much should we study Sanskritam? Then he told one simple one-line answer. He said, if you take the Ramayana Grantha or the Bhagavad Gita Shloka, while reading, if you can understand the Ramayana Shlokas and the Prasanga and shed tears in your eyes, what Valmiki has done, what is the Bhava of Valmiki, when you see Sita Shloka, you also shed tears in your eyes, that is enough. That much of Sanskritam at the first level is enough. Beyond that, if you think that you have the time and effort that you can put it, always put the extra effort that you can learn. So this is what he suggested. Then we thought, we have to put something in place, a framework in place to help people achieve this. Because most of them, when we go and ask them, why do you want to study Sanskritam? If you ask 100 people, probably 80% of the people say, I want to study the text in its original language and understand the text in original. Be it Stotram, be it Gita, Upanishads or Vedas, be it the Ashtapadi, Tarangini or the songs, Muthu Swami Dikshita's songs, be it Natya Shastra in dance, be it Yoga Sutra of Patanjali in Yoga Shastra. Most of them have this desire that for knowledge that this much I have to understand in original. Without the help of translation, if I can understand the text in originality, and if I am able to read a Bhashyam like Shankara Bhashyam or some Bhashyam which some of the Swamijis and Chinmaya itself have written many Bhashyams, if I can read those Bhashyams in its original, then I am Kritartha. That's what everybody's wish, 80% of the people. Of course, few people have put up their steps and said, okay, I want to speak Sanskrit and enjoy the feeling of Sanskrita Graham, etc. And there are a set of people who want to speak Sanskrit and bring it into daily life. There is a set of people who want to understand the text. So broadly, this is the two classifications of people. You can bring in many things, but this is the end. So in that, then we said there is also a Shastra Vakya which they term as Shatashlokena Panditaha. They say Shatashlokena Panditaha, which means if you read 100 shlokas, you become a Pandita. So, Panda, Pandita definition in Shankara Bhasha is Panda, Atma Vishaya Jnanam, Yasya Asti. Panda itukte Atma Vishaya Jnanam, Yasya Asti Saha Panditaha. So, how to become a Pandita with only reading 100 shlokas? So, if this kind of a shortcut is given to us, everybody would like to grab this. This is the world of instant gratification and etc. If some shortcut method is there, even the students will be very motivated. Ah, let me study Sanskrit and become a Pandita. So, we are today going to explore that method which makes you one shloka first in Ramayana, then we will do. We have Bhagavad Gita also, we will do one in Bhagavad Gita also. Based on the time. One, if we understand, definitely we can do all like that. So, we will try to explore that path. What is that path which elders have told, by which if I read 100 shlokas, I can become a knowledgeable person. Let us not get into Pandita word as the definition of Shankaracharya. A knowledgeable person. We can understand the Mula directly. This is the objective of today's. For that, we have Samskrita Adhyayanam also, we have Bhasha Adhyayanam, Grantha Adhyayanam, Shastra Adhyayanam. This yesterday we covered, so I will get into the overall framework of today's lecture. So the first stage is called, first, these are the steps. This slide will talk about the overall steps. And we will get into each of these steps and experience it ourselves. That is the objective of today. For some, maybe we will do an activity. So we have a sheet where you can write something. We will guide you. Some Sanskritam, people who know Sanskritam, if there are anybody from Sanskrit Bharati or anybody who knows Sanskritam and who have studied some level of Sanskritam, they can also facilitate the process if they want to. The first step is active listening. I'll just name it, that's all. Explanation will happen in a moment. The second step is pronunciation. Third step is Pathana Koshanam, reading skill. Fourth step is Manana Koshanam. Memorizing in the sense it's not children memorizing. Mananam, take it to the heart. Oh, that shloka should appeal to you. That is Mananam. Arthadhi, basic meaning. First is splitting of the words. Then word to word meaning. Then gist of the overall bhava, which is called tatparyam. Then little bit of vyakaranamsha to supplement the bhava and get to know the exactness or appropriateness of the expression. So in that we require sandhi. Some of these things we will require when we do the arthajnanam part. So part of it we will use in arthajnanam part, part we will explore here also. Then samasa, splitting of the words. Then we have other grammar related aspects like Tudanta, Sabdita and all, which we need to know. That is the third step. The fourth step is Sahityamshaha, literary aspects. So any poem can be seen in different views. If you say literary view, then what is the word used? Why Mahaprana is used? Why the starting letter is this letter? All those kinds of analysis is Sahityamshaha, basic literary points. And chandas, the meter, in what chandas it is composed and why it is composed in this chandas. Certain granthas, they get composed in a certain meter, prosody they call. Prosody is not the exact translation of chandas, but it is a way it is constructed, the science of construction of a poem. Then the figure of speech, which is alankara. Then we have kosha related aspects. So there could have been a possibility of using another word instead of this word, because Sanskrit has a rich dictionary of words, say 1.2 billion words are there in Sanskrit. So why did this word come there? Is there any significance of using this word? Especially in Bhagavad Gita, you will notice that some certain words are specifically used by Bhagavan Vyasa. And Shankara Bhasha, you will have that and say why this word is put. So, that we have to understand. Then the Tattvartha Anveshman, Like our, when the Jagadgurus of Chinmaya come here, they explain the import and the inner meaning and all those things. That is at that level. The real intent of the shloka, what is that import we have to take? Yesterday we saw Anirveda Shriyo Moolam, Anirveda Shriyam Tapaha. The real import of that and how deep it was. All those kind of points, special aspects and special vyakhyanas is in the Tattvartha Anveshan. That is a never-ending process. So if you ask me, the first level is between Prathamastara and Arthajnana. If we come till there, and little bit of Vyakaranamsa, if we come till there, we are almost done. We have achieved the first part. That is, when you read a shloka, you are going to understand it directly from Sanskrit. This is the first stage we have to achieve. Then balance we can achieve later. So this is the overall framework which we will be doing. In that, let us take the first shloka of Ramayana. The first shloka of Ramayana goes like this. So I will tell and you can repeat with me. Or I will wait for you to repeat. Tapaswadhyaya niratam.
Tapaswadhyaya niratam.
Tapasvi vadvidam varam.
Tapasvi vadvidam varam.
Naradam paripapraccha.
Naradam paripapraccha.
Valmikir munipungavam.
Valmikir munipungavam.
Excellent chanting. So, tapasvadhyaya niratam. The first step in that slide was active listening. So ideally, you listen to me and you also repeat it, right? So now, I will just...
Tapasvadhyaya niratam. Tapasvadhyaya niratam. Tapasvi vadvidam varam. Tapasvi vadvidam varam.
Now, having listened to this shloka, we have a tool on Ramayana Ratnamala. This is the activity. Let us identify together five important pronunciation nuances in this shloka. And let me put it back there so that you can see and identify. Anybody, this is an activity, so I would request you to participate. I am sure you know certain things. Irrespective of whether you know Sanskrit, I am sure you will be able to tell it because your regional language also has this. Any regional Indian language will have this feature.
Paripapraccha.
Paripapraccha.
Tapasvi. Tapasvi.
What is that? So the activity.
Paripapraccha means?
No, meaning I don't want. At this stage, I don't want the meaning. I will definitely come to you, Bhagini Mata, for meaning. At this stage, I want the pronunciation nuances. How do we pronounce?
Paripapraccha. Tapasvi. Vagvadam varam.
Vagvidam varam.
Vagvidam varam. Naradam
paripapraccha.
Paripapraccha. Valmiki.
Valmikir munipungava.
Valmikir munipungava. Pungavan.
Pungavan. Okay. So I think she wanted to read it. Somebody wants to recite it. Individually, somebody wants to recite it. First we can do that step and then go to the activity. Bhagini.
A different tune though.
Any tune is okay.
Tapasvadhyaya niratam. Tapasvi vadvidambaram. Naradam paripapraccha. Valmikir munipungavam.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Mata. Now, anybody else want to chant? Anybody wants to volunteer? No.
Tapaswadhyaya niratam tapasvi vadvinam varam nagaram paripapachara valmigir munipungavam.
Excellent. Anybody wants to chant?
Tapaswadhyaya niratam tapasvi vadvinam varam naradam paripapachara valmigir munipungavam.
Okay. Excellent. Excellent. Anybody wants to chant? One question I have. We have, that is Devanagari script for Sanskrit. What is that, Mrs. Below?
Translation.
How do we get that? So, paripapraksha, see, in English, if I do transliteration, I can do it in different ways. I can put, see, I put praksha, I put P-R-A-C-C-H-A. What is that which makes me put P-R-A-C-C-H-A? And if you see, Vagvidambaram, A, I put a dash above. It indicates something, and what is it? That entire transliteration. How do we get that? So there is, No, all that is okay, but how do you get that script in this form?
I trans.
So there is an international standard of convention for people who don't know Devanagari script. Like many people in Andhra or in Karnataka, they study Ramayana. But they use a script, Telugu script or Kannada script. In Tamil Nadu, they use Tamil script. But they are studying Sanskrit only, but the script will be different. So like that, for people who don't know Devanagari script, we have this IAST, International Standards for Roman Transliterations called. It is called diacriticals. People say diacriticals because it has got marks above, below and all. So, in Google, if you search for IAST, you will get to know how, and then you just write from Devanagari to IAST converter. If you just put in Google, you will get a tool called Sanskrit or something. If there is a Wi-Fi, oh, there is a Wi-Fi here.
Yes.
So I can show you my right showing. So, Devanagari to IAST converter. So, if you see this tool, now you can take this shloka here. I'm sure this is an offline thing, but it helps you many times if you give. This is International Alphabet of Sanskrit Transliteration. This is the also, then there is a Diga form, etc. etc. The spelling can be given as per that. See, what happens is many times they go to a numerologist or somebody and ask whether this number of letters is okay and other things. The numerologist goes back to Sanskrit and then only decides that for us. Now, this was the step that we went through. The next one, so now we didn't finish that activity itself. So, which are the five, identify the five nuances of pronunciation in this shloka. The Tapaswadhyaya.
One is Alpa Prana Maha Prana.
Very good. So the first thing, and where it is formed? Swadhyaya Niratam. Dhyaya. Swadhyaya is different. Swadhyaya is different. So Maha Prana means more effort. So every letter, so the background, after we finish the activity, I will tell you the background of this pronunciation and how Sanskrit, what is the construction of. This is one is Alpa Prana Maha Prana. This is one nuance.
I have a doubt. Or maybe if you read that, the word Bagbidam. But if I read it step by step, it is Bagi Badam. Right?
No. What? Bagvidam.
But it says Bagi Badam. Is that right? So why I'm saying Bhagvidam? That's what I'm trying to.
Vadvidam, see, again you have Gunitakshara and Samyuktakshara in Sanskrit. You have letters, joining with consonants. Swaras, you have basic vowels, vowels joining with consonants, and consonants joining with each other. Now, Vadvidam Varam is a case of Ga joining, the sound Ga joining with Va and E as the Swara ending. Vadvi, Gri, Gri. Nasika, no, it doesn't come from the Nasika. Ga, Dam, Am comes from Nasika. So, Vagvidam, that is how we have to, the sound, see in Sanskrit what they have given, first there was a sound. The sound has given, has been given a script, a form, that form is actually associated to a god. That there is why the why A is written like this only. In English language, you write A like this. Do they have a science of writing this A? In Sanskritam, there is a science. There is a kosha called Vachaspatyam and Shabdartha, Shabdakalpadrima. In those koshas, for writing Akara, what is the benefit of writing Akara like that? That is discussed and it tells you there is a science of writing that Akara in that. So Akara is the Parabrahma Swarupa. Parabrahma Swarupa, the formless God is represented by Akara, is represented by the sound Akara. And you should get the energy of a formless God in Akara. That is what is the science of writing also. There exists a science. Though it is a science which has come later, because our original tradition was fully oral tradition, which is this one, it has come later, but there have been. And that is the basis of the Tantra Shastra, where you, there is a Bijaksharam, there is a Yantra on which to meditate, all this comes from there. So now, let us not deviate much from the subject. Vadvidam Varam has got that Samyuktakshara, which is why we have to pronounce that. The second nuances in activity, somebody who wants to. See, actually, if you let us read letter by letter, pa, ri, pa, pra, cha. So, pariva, pra, pariva, where sometimes, because of the word coming from Vedas, all these words, the forced twin, two times uchara, dhritvam, like dharma kshetre, that is what we said. We don't say dharma kshetre, you don't tell dharma kshetre kima kurvata, that extra stress is there, no? That is a very important pronunciation nuance. It was actually, I'm very surprised that you identified it first. Very thank you very much for that identification, and that is called vidvam, and it is there, and that is because we all pronounce it because of regional influence and the Vedic influence, the Vedic DNA inside us. We give dhritvam at some places. That is, as per Vyakarana, it is Vyakarana Shastram, it is Vikalpam, optional. But it is better, and we naturally give it. Like Dharma Kshetre and Paripap Pracha. There we have this dhritvam, which is good. That is one thing. Okay, some simpler things are also there.
Combination.
Excellent. So Valmikihi Munipungavam is there. There Valmikir Munipungavam has happened. That is combination of two letters at Visarga, which is the Sandhi. So the signs of joining letters. We will be covering that in Palacheda and further. So Valmikihi Munipungavam. There has been a Sandhi there. Okay, very good. Any other thing? Excellent. So see the writing here. here, tapasvadhyaya niratam is what we said. And here, tapaha in the book it will be probably tapaha svadhyaya niratam, but together only it will be there. So the visarga changing to sakara is tapasvadhyaya niratam. So tapasvadhyaya niratam, that is also a sandhi phenomenon. Any other? Anuswara. Niratam vadvidam naradam. That pronunciation is anuswara. So we have to observe the anuswara pronunciation. And if anuswara is followed by vakara, there. Vadvidam varam. So the natural tendency is that takes another form of vakara. Vadvidam varam. Okay. Ma and a stroke. That is the writing aspect of it. But pronunciation, ma or half ma and anuswara same.
Another observation. Pungavam.
Pungavam. What is that?
The verse in English, if you see, it's as if you need to have a dot on the top. But that's not how it is written in Sanskrit.
Again, that is a writing aspect. But still, pungavam, yes, the writing. Now, Pungavam has got the Anunasika Akshara. The point he is trying to tell, the hidden point which he is trying to tell, is not able to communicate, express it. Pungavam has got the Anunasika letters. That is Kha, Kha, Ga, Ga, Na. Ch, Cha, Cha, Ja, Ja, Nya. Da, Tha, Da, Dha, Na. Da, Tha, Da, Dha, Na. So, Tata Dadana, Papa Papa Ma, all this Ma, Nakara, very easy. Nakara also very easy. In Hindi also it is same. But here, the first two Vargas, Pungavam, that Na has to come from the throat and Nya has to come from the palate. Chavargas last letter, Kavargas last letter has to come from different regions. Why, sir, we are supposed to understand the meanings? You are making us afraid in the first step by telling all these nuances. The benefit of reciting the shloka. See, we need the benefit of reciting the shloka. And there are many benefits like memory, pronunciation, etc. And the meaning changes sometimes. In one of the products, we have the demonstration. For example, there is a word called phalam. What is phalam? Fruit. Suppose you would tell it is phalam. Our first point, that is what Chintigneji said, alpa prana maha prana. He knows where is the sukshma. That is why he gave that as a first thing. If you do phalam versus phalam, what is the difference? Phalam is meat. M-E-A-T, meat. So, phalam yachha, somebody comes and tells in your house, you give him meat, how will you feel? So, pronunciation, and in Saundarya Lahari, there is a shloka. Tomeka naivasi prakatitavara bhitya vinaya asi tom asi. There is one shloka. There, if you suddenly put asi, asi, asi means khadgaha, asi, two swords. So instead of telling, oh Devi, you are blessing me, you are Tomeka Nivasi, you are there, you are Eka, all those things, are you coming with two swords? The meaning is changing. So there has a bigger. So Alpa Prana, and there's one more example. Bala Chandraha. Okay? Bala Chandraha. What is the difference between Bala and Bala? Anybody knows? Bala. No, Baal in some Hindi is hair. Little boy. Balaha means little boy in Sanskrit. So now Balaha Chandraha is a saha. The little moon. Moon in its in moon has got Shvarshakalaha, 16 days to little moon on the head. Or well, the moon which is in small in shape. Balaha means forehead. So one who has moon on his forehead is Bala Chandraha. So when you are doing Archana to Shiva or somebody, Bala Chandraha is more appropriate than Bala Chandraha. Or Devi also, Lalita Parameshwari, she has a moon on her head, Rajarajeshwari. So we have to be very careful when we are pronouncing this. The meaning changes. Suddenly meaning changes. And when we are writing the shloka, when we are practicing the shloka, we get confused. Oh, is it Balachandra? Balachandra? What did it? What was I telling mom these days? Oh, I don't know. Like that. And you know the meaning difference and you don't know what you are pronouncing. So pronunciation is very important stuff. The other thing which, any other thing which is left out?
I noticed few different people chanting in different tunes, but everyone stopped, where they stopped was always common.
Exactly, that is Chandas. So, in Sanskrit there is a science called Chandas, which is there in the Sahitya Amsha, but since he raised it, I will tell you. So, this is called Anushtup Chandas. Entire Ramayana, most of the shlokas, most 80% of the Ramayana shlokas out of 24,000 is written in Anushtup Chandas. Anushtup Chandas has got these characteristics. It will have 16 letters in one line and 8 letters in one pada. So which is why we all stopped at the 8th letter. Both for ragam and for other reasons also. See, the other reasons are, it's a natural pranayama. We cover this in Power of Sanskrit lectures. We make everybody recite different types of shloka and tell how reciting helps you in pranayama. So this is a Nadi Shodhana pranayama, where you get the effect of doing a natural breathing exercise at the end of 8 letters. Suppose we take the shloka, Shantakaram Bhujaga Shayanam Padmanabham Suresham. Say that is about 14 letters or 15 letters, everybody stops there. So that is the natural pranayama which is enabled by our Sanskrit shlokas. We can cover that in, we are covering that in, in Power of Sanskrit series. And we have Bhastrika Pranayama set of shlokas. We have Brahmani set of shlokas. Different shlokas we have, which gives effect of different pranayamas. So you can watch our Power of Sanskrit videos, which we have conducted over the US tour. And the first power we cover is this. So we are still in the first step. There were few nuances that we couldn't recognize. If anybody wants to recognize, okay, let us go to the slide. The first one is Hrasva Deerga, the short vowel and the long vowel. So in Vagvidam Varam, if I tell Vagvidam Varam, that Deerga should come. Swadhyaya Niratam, Deerga is there. Tapas Swadhyaya Niratam. Su Adhyayaha Swadhyayaha. Sva Adhyayaha Swadhyayaha. A nice, so the meaning changes. Su Adhyaya means a good chapter. Swadhyaya means it is Swadhyaya. If I start explaining Swadhyaya, Swadhyaya has got 3 pages of explanation in the Bhashya. Swadhyaya is referred to Veda, Swadhyaya is referred to Upanishads. So lot of things are there which I will cover in the Tattvartha. Now, so you see how just a small difference in Swadhyaya, Swadhyaya, Rasva Deerga. If you make that error, it affects the meaning. Then Alpa Prana Maha Prana, what Jignesh ji said, difference between the nasal letters, what our Mahodaya said, difference between Sha, Sha, Sa. tapasvadhyayanatam. Here the easy one was there, sa. Whereas in Bhagavad Gita, in suppose we say shanmukha, so can anybody tell the difference and pronounce these three words? Shivaha, shanmukha, Saraswati. Who wants to try this?
Saraswati, Shivaha, Shanmukaha.
Ah. Anybody wants to try? Good effort.
Shiva,
Shanmukha,
Saraswati.
Excellent.
Shiva, Shanmukha, Saraswati.
Good effort.
Shiva, Shanmukha, Saraswati.
Good effort is what I can tell. Where are we slightly? We have to observe this. Shiva, everybody will do it right. Saraswati, Mata is there, she helps us. Shanmukha, we have to roll the tongue. Shanmukha has the origin as Rutu Rashanam Murdha, the hard palate. So our tongue should touch the hard palate. Shanmukha. Otherwise, in Sanskritam, the writing has, every script has got a different pronunciation. If the pronunciation is same, the script also has to be same. So, when Shiva Shah is different, Shanmukha Shah is different, and Saraswati Shah is different. This is very important. Many times, unknowingly, because of the effect of the regional influence, regional language influence, we tend to error on that side. But there is, so Shasha. I will think about an example where you can change the meaning also. Difference between Nisarga and Hakara. So tapas swadha, tapaha swadha, Nisarga if it is there, and Hakara. Hakara is, you should have the chest influence to pronounce Hakara. Hey Gopalaka, hey Kripa Chalanidhe, hey Sindhu Kanyapate, hey Kamadeva Kapala. That visarga is from Kantha, Hakara is from the little bit of chest pushing forward. So that, otherwise, if you are dictating to somebody and if they are writing and if they are following the pronunciation Shastra, they will not be able to give out the same output. That is another aspect. For us, the meaning is very important, for which we have to focus on the meaning. Nuances in compound letters, we saw Vag Vidam Varam. Maholi asked a question which helped us arrive at the compound letters. A vyanjana, a consonant combining with a consonant is a compound letter. A swara combining with a vyanjana, like k plus a, ka. K plus A, ka, 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 ki, ki. All that is gunitakshara, that is just Purnakshara. Whereas K plus Ta, Ta, Shaktihi, Yuktihi, Muktihi. All that is compound letter. Sayutakshara, which we call. So that is special Visarga guidelines. I think we covered it on Anuswara. Chandrasekhar Mahoday covered it. So what happens when we pronounce these shlokas in this way? The mouth gym happens, and there are research papers which natural pranayama increase motoring usage of the brain parts. Suppose sha, sha, simple example. Suppose you pronounce shanmukha as sha only. Now, I told you, all of us were asked to pronounce three words. Shivaha, shanmukha, Saraswati. Each letter will have a neuron in the brain. It will store, right? We have to recall that letter while pronouncing. Now you pronounce Shanmukha also as Shisha Talavya Shakara. The same neuron gets activated rather than the other neuron which was there, which was waiting. Somebody will call me, I have to, still waiting, just waiting. So that doesn't get activated at all in the brain. If you continue this pronunciation for lot of words and don't pronounce shakara in the way it has to be pronounced, your brain activation, etc. of that part, is you are preventing that to happen. So this is what, see, this is very scientific.
So you're going on some very nuanced areas. One of the first things you had mentioned was between Raswa and Deerga. Maybe we should take some more basic examples like Rama and Rama.
Excellent.
And Krishna and Krishna, and what the differences are.
Yeah, excellent point, sir. So Ramaha is there. Now, suppose instead of Rama, Rama is the Pratipadika root form of a person named Rama. Instead of that, if you say Rama, so in what happens in India is, Karnataka, in Karnataka, people use this Dirgha influence is not there. And in Uttara Bharata, Ram, 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 Ramji, Ram, Jairamji, Jairamji, Ram, Ram, Rama, for that person, Rama is incorrect. The actual thing is Rama, it is not Ram, it is not Rama. That is what Mahadeva was telling. Thank you very much, sir.
But Rama, Rama has a meaning.
Yeah.
Rama is a woman.
No, no, I will come to that. Meaning wise, I will come to that. First pronunciation, that is why Ramante Yoginaha Yasmin Saha Ramaha. On whom the yogis meditate is Rama. That is the Dasharati Rama, the Treta Yuga, Ramayana's Rama. Now he is telling Rama has also got a meaning. Wife of Rama, if you have added as a top pratyaya, Akarantasthirina, like Shivaha, Shiva, Shiva, Shiva. Shivaha is our Lord Shiva. Shiva is Shiva's Patni, La Goddess Parvati. Same way, Krishnaha is Krishna. Sometimes Krishna, it may not be Patni always. Krishna is Draupadi. Krishna is Draupadi. Same way, we have Gopaha, Gopa. Gopaha, Gopi is also there. Gopaha, Gopa is also there. Two words are there. Gopaha, Gopa, Gopasya, Patni, Gopa. Gopi is anybody who is belongs to the clan of Gopas. Gopi. So the Hrasva Dirgha, which is very important, I think basic examples like this. At that time we should clearly pronounce that, and it has a difference in meaning. So when you are referring to Krishna Shloka and you are referring Krishna, you say Krishna, then what happens? You are not praying to Lord Krishna, you are praying to Draupadi. It ends up like that. So that is what I think Mahadeva wanted.
Rama is Sampadana.
Hey Rama. Again it is Rama. Hrasva Swara has got one mantra for pronunciation. Mantra is the time taken for pronunciation. So, if you want to practice that, I can show you, let us all do that pronunciation, so that it becomes an activity. I have to make sound with, sir.
If people want to take 5-minute bio break, whenever you feel appropriate time to...
At this, when I finish this, when I start the Padachera, I can give a break. So now, let me take this... this is one sound. Now, time taken for pronunciation of a, thank you very much for pointing out that, sir. Time taken for pronunciation of a letter is called mantra. Now, A, if you want to pronounce A, it takes one mantra. How do you get, make this, practice this with kids? In our Sanskrit class, we do this. We take two instruments and we say, A, A, E, E, U, U. So two mantras means by the time I do two times, you have to keep the pronunciation on till that time. R, R, A. Now can you do A like this? If it is Kannada, you can do like that. If it is in Sanskrit, Hindi, A is a Dirgha Swara. There is no A is not there. The Swara itself is A only. A, I, O, Au. Dirgasa, Am, Aha. Again, that 1.5, you have to lightly increase it. So, this is a pronunciation, Matra Kala. So, Rama, Hey Rama, when you pronounce, Hey Rama, Ma has got half Matra, Vyanjana, all the Vyanjanas have got half mantra for pronunciation, and the full Akshara Akara has got one mantra. So one and a half mantra is Ma. That is the time you have to give for the pronunciation of the letter. So this is how we practice. And Alpa Prana Mahaprana, we have a good method. Again, I thank Mahodaya for reminding this. So we take this paper. I keep it like this. Bhima. 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 So that is the extra effort which we have to put. So that this Bhima, it goes like this. For children, if you want to make them practice this, Alpa Prana Mahaprana. Ka, ka. So you should keep it nicely. Ka, ka. Ga, ga. Na. So we should practice using the paper so that we can understand the effect of Bahya Prayatna, which we are giving on the letter. Very, very important. Rasvadiga, Alpa Prana Mahaprana has got, it can change the meaning. Visarga, as he rightly said, Visarga, Anuswara and all are the other aspects in pronunciation, in Siksha Shastra, but these two are very, very important. Hrasva Dirgha, and what happens in Sangeeta also, in music also, you have these ragas, there you have this alapadams and all these things. Because of that, the tend to pull it. So we have the Ramakrishna Bhagavatam whom I showed. He is an excellent exponent of Nama Sankirtan. Here too, some of his pronunciations. So he will say, which is the raga? Why is it that you can't pronounce it as per Sanskritam and also have the raga's beauty there? So he will show us in front, this is how it has to be pronounced. And so Chandrasekhar Raman, who is here, he has seen our Bhagavatam in India. And he has proven that, see, for the sake of raga, you need not sacrifice Sanskrit as pronunciation. So he's a scholar in both areas, so he shows us that. This is very important. Next is the reading skill, Parayanasya Mahatvam. We'll finish reading skill, the first part, and we'll take a break. Parayanasya Mahatvam, how do we read this? So, all of us, if we are doing Nitya Parayana of some shlokas, of course, we will be going in speed and other things to finish the portions, all those things. Racing against time will be there. But the para, why elders tell us to do parayana? Suppose Veda, see, this I experienced in my childhood. There was Veda Parayana going in. My father and my grandfather were Vedic scholars. They used to call other Vedic pandits and chant the entire Krishna Yajurveda for 7 days or 6 days. Every day, 4 hours in the morning, 4 hours in the afternoon, with some breaks, of course. All the breaks will be there. So they used to chant. My father used to say, cut. Sit and listen to the Veda Parayana. At that time I was about 7th standard, 9th standard. What they are chanting, definitely we are unable to understand. And they go with, because they have to complete the portion, they go in tremendous speed. In Sanskritam, what happens is, the Shabda Rashi is too much. If you include the Vedic Shabda Rashi, you have lot of Shabdas. That vocabulary is too big. Number of Shabdas, so in the dictionary, if there are 3 lakh words or something, or 1.5 lakh words in our Munir Williams or some dictionary, it doesn't mean those are the words which are existing in Sanskrit. So many words are there. That is the first point. To get to know all those words was a challenge. It's a challenge for anybody in Sanskrit. Now, for example, a word Vrikshaha. Why there are so many words? Vrikshaha. Vrikshaha means tree. In English, do you have a synonym for a tree? If you have, what is it? Do you have a synonym for a tree in English? So I googled out. Even I didn't know it. Having studied English for 30 years, we don't know a synonym for tree. I thought there must be something. If you google out, it will give you some plant, shrub, all those different options from the thesaurus it will give. But in Sanskritam, the case is like this. Vrikshaha, tree. Mahiruhaha, padapaha, taruhu, salaha, anokaha, kutaha, shala. Suppose I am just giving you a few which I know, which I am remembering at the top of my mind from Amara. Now, what is vrikshaha? It is telling, it gives the characteristics of that padartha. Padartha jnanena mokshaha. Now, padartha, the padartha is, vrikshaha is coming from the dhatu, o vrikshu chedane, which means that which can be cut. Chedanam nama cut. O vrikshu chedane. So, that is, it is that object which can be cut. So, we cut. Then, padapaha. So, padhyam pivati iti padapaha. That which drinks water from the ground, the pada. Padhyam pivati iti padapaha. Shakhi is another name. Shakaha asya santi. It has got lot of branches. Shakhi. Then another thing was mahi ruhaha. Mahi is earth. Ruhaha grows. That which grows on earth. Mahi ruhaha. You see, these etymological derivations helps us to understand the characteristic of the padartha, and that is how Sanskritam has been. Any word can be traced to its root. Now, because of this number of, so I am coming back to the Veda Parayanam incident, any number of words will have some number of synonyms. For Bhagavan Vishnu, you have Sahasranama only existing. For Shiva, you have an Ayutanama Sahasranama. For Lakshmi, there is a Sahasranama. For Alita, there is a Sahasranama. So, lot of, but that is out of bhakti or extrapolation, but basically the word itself has got, like Riksha for example, has got many words to express us. Karanam, Ananam, Vipinam, Aranyam, Atavi. All this means forest. Vanam. So these are forests. Like that we have Silanam. There is a Kosha which is called Amara Kosha, which is probably brings about some 3000 lines and it leaves about an average of 15,000 words. Normally used words which we all can practice. Now, why this? Now, Veda Parayanam, when we, the reading skill, why it is important? Many people say, without understanding the meaning, I am not going to do any Parayanam. These days, children, they say this. They say, what is the use of doing reading the shloka without understanding the meaning? That's the first step they come up. But in my experience, when I was sitting in that Parayanam, in Krishna Yajurveda, there is an prasanga which where they discuss about Gardabaha, Rasabaha. These are the two words which come in that vakya. Gardabaha means what? Donkey. Rasabaha also donkey. Now what has donkey do to, what has donkey to do with Vedas? Why is a donkey coming inside Vedas? This is the question. Today we do 700 shlokas of Gita. Somebody listens to the Gita, we'll pick up 2-3 words. Karma, Jnana, Bhakti, Sannyasa, Krishna, Rishikesha, Parantapa, Arjuna, Mudakesha. These are the words which will keep on coming. He will at least pick these words and then ask, what is Mudakesha? What is Rishikesha? What is Parantapa? What is the meaning of? So, this thing happens in when we listen. When we do Parayanam also, even without knowing the meaning, we get this. Apart from that, we need to get the reading skill to read it correctly after understanding this. So this helps in understanding the meaning, like our Mananam, Nididhyasanam, and the steps are there. It's in Vedanta Marga, they say. Like that, we need these steps, just the reading skill. Shrutam Harati Papani is the Shruti Vakya. If you go through this Devi Saptashati, in the Rahasya Trayam, they say Shrutam Harati Papani. So by listening itself, listening to Vedas, Papani goes away. You get the parichaya of the word. Each word has got a Shabda Shakti. How does the sin goes away and all, that's a different question, not in this forum. But there is a Shakti in that word itself, because of which we get the Punyam. Because those words are the words recited by the Rishis, and they are Apurushaya Vak. Now, we take now reading skill. This is one text from the same Tapaswadhyaya, but from a commentary. So this is how a commentary will look. A Anybody wants to try reading one line? Send a second. Upanishad bhagah ityate aha. Thank you very much. Tatra pratipadaka. So when the reading skill, how long we have to practice this reading skill? This is one of the thing. So we have to practice the reading skill to such an extent that we don't come back on the text. Dharma kshetre kuru kshetre, we go at one stretch. Suppose we come back, dharma kshetre, and kshetre we are not sure of what it is, we come back. Like that if you are doing, we have to practice till we do not come back. And we should of course know all the padachaya we should know, so that we can split at the appropriate place. All those things also we should know along with the reading skill. Now for the shlokas, what happens is, this is a gadya and it's a commentary, because Jigneshji said some of us are studying Bhashya and there are different study groups here. I just thought I should put one Bhashya line also, and we just understand how it has to be read. So I think we can give a break after this. Now there is one shloka which is called Yadyati Bahuna Dhishe Pataputra Vyakaranam. So the father tells to his son, if you don't study much also, study the basics of the language and basics of grammar. Why? Swajanaha Swajano Mabhut. Swajanaha. What is the meaning of Swajanaha? Our people. In Telugu they say very nicely, what is it? Manavaru. Very Swajana. But if you use Swajanaha instead of Swajanaha, Shwa is dog. What happens to the meaning? So in one village somebody calls, hey Swajanaha, Agachantu Manavaru. They say, hey Swajanaha. Then the entire meaning goes away. And Sakalam Shakalam. In Karnataka, you have this place called Ramanathapura and other places, Mathur, where they, Sanketi people are, you know, Sanketi people, when they are serving food, they have this Mora, which means a big V-shaped Shurpa. They have this and they serve Annam and all using that. Now, one fellow who is sitting on the ground, he says, instead of Sakrit Parivesaya, Sakrit Parivesaya is one time you do, Shakrit Parivesaya, Shakrit is cowder. And Sakalam, Shakalam is a piece or a portion, Sakalam is entire thing. So the entire thing which is there in that Mora, they will pour on that. This was just a So we have to know the difference between, these are small words which has differences. Rasva Divya Mahodaya pointed out. The Valparana Mahaprana, we saw some examples. So pronunciation and reading is very important step in understanding the meaning also. We have a reading skill in one of our products where it helps you. I'll finish this reading skill and release I'll just show you how it helps you to read the skill. We'll go directly to the skills and we take only the first, the listening skill and the reading skill. in the listening skill? Let us go to the words as he was, Mahadeva was telling. So these are some of the words. Dharaha, dharaha. So I will not make to do this exercise, but I'll just show the difference in meaning. Just you see that. Poison, holding. Ganga, dharaha versus Ganga, dharaha. What is the impact we are creating? Bhala, balaha versus bhalaha. Oh, sorry, I have to show the meaning. Balaha versus balaha. Yes. English is boy and forehead. Skandaha, skandaha. English translation. Shoulder, Kartikeya. Nakaha, nakaha. Nail in heaven. Mitram versus mitraha. That is our God. Mitram is friend. Mitraha is sun god. Kapalaha, kapolaha. See the difference? Skull and cheek. These are some of the examples.
Antram.
Antram, yantram. What is antram? Any idea? Antram, intestine. Yantram is machine. Dhruvaha, dhruvaha. This may not, this mistake may not occur. Dhruvaha is the name of a
star.
Patram, patram. Many people, many students make this mistake. Leave for Brazil at the beginning stage. Kupaha, supaha. Well, so understanding the letter itself. Kataha, katihi. Kataha is mat. Katihi is lace. Pakashala versus Pakashala. I'm sure all of us know this. Jalam, jala. Jalam, jala. Jalam is net or mesh. Takram, chakram. All of us know this. Amsaha, amshaha. Very important. Amshavataraha, Ramavataraha, Amshavataraha. So, Bhagavan Vishnu was there in heaven and he incarnated himself as an Amshavatara. So, Amshavatara. Amsaha is shoulder. Amshaha is portion. Nupuram, Gopuram, I'm sure. Karaha, Karaha. Very important. Donkey. Versus hand. Kukkuraha, kukkutaha. Dog and cock. Sakrit, sakrit, visada. Akaraha, akaraha. What is the difference? Akaraha versus akaraha. Sorry. Akaraha is
akara.
Source or reference. Akara granthaha. So what is the bibliography when we write? The bibliography in a research paper, we write akara granthaha. From where we have taken the references for our presentation. That is akara. Akaraha is form.
Asi.
Asi, asihi. Asi, you are. Swad is asihi. Vyajanam, vyajanam. What is the difference? Ha. So vyanjanam is a side dish. Vyajanam is a fan. So like this, there are a lot of things. Granthihi, granthaha. So we know that. Not versus text. So if I can go to the other skill. So we understood why that it has an impact on the meaning, which is why we have to listen, read and pronounce properly. Reading skill, if you take, we'll straight away get into the last part, which is read verses. We'll just go through this. So how do we practice this? We can use these kind of products. Our main thing is to do Nitya Parayana. Kama and Nisya Nitya Parayana. Bhagavad Gita Nitya Parayana. That is the best thing to practice your reading. If you have some audio CDs, etc., well and good. But in front of God, many times we don't want to put all those technology. We keep that away and we want to pray. Start reading and be very clear on that. And get the letters right, Gunita Akshara right, and see how they are pronounced. This is the meaning you have some questions on that routine as a part of this part. So this is reading skill. First we have to start from words, then go to sentences, and then go to the verses. That is the krama. So start reading simple words first, then go. How to practice this? So this finishes the first part of to some extent. We have come till reading skill. Next we get into the padachheda skills. Before we get into the padachheda, I think we should take a break, as I rightly said. So we will have a, how many minutes break, the number of minutes?
10 minutes is okay?
Yeah. So 10:40, 10:50 you can.
Yeah. 10:50 in this clock.